So today I'll give you a 50 to 55 minute synopsis of a book that I just published that's titled The Evolutionary Basis of Consumption. So what I really want to do by the end of this talk is hopefully give you a good sense of how we could have a nexus between evolutionary theory and consumption. And by consumption here, I use the term in a much more encompassing sense than the consumption of toothpaste and beer and cars. But we consume friendships, we consume religious narratives, we consume mates. So I'm really using the term consumption in a grand sense. So the title of my talk, as I said, is The Evolutionary Basis of Consumption. I'm going to give you a brief agenda for today's talk. I'll begin by very briefly telling you about the paucity of Darwinian theory in consumer research. There's almost, despite a very rich body of academic literature, there is almost no mention of biology or certainly of evolutionary theory in consumer behavior, which seems quite remarkable that we could study the consuming mind without ever recognizing that we're biological beings. Then I'll demonstrate how we could take all types of consumption acts and map them onto key Darwinian modules. And that will provide you with a good idea of how consilient, by consilient we mean unity of knowledge, how much organization could be reaped by adopting a meta-framework such as Darwinian theory and understanding consumption. Then I will briefly talk about advertising content and demonstrate how advertising content is really a reflection of our evolved human nature, which incidentally is completely contrary to what most social constructionists would argue, which is that we're born with empty minds, and then it's advertising that fills our minds. Of course, I'm arguing the exact opposite causal mechanism. I'm arguing that advertising content exists in that form because it is catering to our evolved human mind. So it's the exact opposite causal mechanism. Then I will expand the discussion from advertising to other products of popular culture, song lyrics, movie themes, videos, religious narratives. And then I'll demonstrate that we could study these products of popular culture and also demonstrate that they are reflective, they are an instantiation of our evolved human nature. Then I will very, very briefly, because I'll probably be close to running out of time, talk about dark side consumption. These are consumption acts that yield deleterious consequences, pathological gambling, compulsive buying, and so on. And I'll demonstrate, I'll try to argue that they possess a Darwinian root or Darwinian etiology. And then I will wrap up by summarizing what are some of the benefits reaped by Darwinizing consumer research. And if we have time, I'll talk about some recent empirical research that I've done with some of my colleagues. So before I do that, I thought that maybe this audience, given that it's a very interdisciplinary audience, as Carl explained to me, that it might be useful that I provide you with a very, very quick tutorial, a one-slide tutorial on what some of the key tenets of evolutionary theory, or certainly evolutionary psychology are, sort of to contextualize the rest of the discussion. So one of the really important points to note about evolutionary theory is that it operates at the ultimate level, and I'll explain what these mean in a second. Much of science operates at the proximate level. By proximate level, we're talking about how a mechanism operates, what are some factors that affect this mechanism. So it's looking at a mechanistic view of how things operate. So it's the how and what questions. And in a second, I'll give you an example that will make this clear. On the other hand, evolutionary theory, by definition, looks at ultimate explanations. By ultimate, we mean the evolutionary reason that this particular phenomenon, behavior, cognition, emotion, morphological trait would have arisen to be of that type. So it's the ultimate why. Why would it have evolved to be of this form? It's very important to know that this is something that I consistently discuss and debate and I'd like to say explain to some of my colleagues in the business school. Arguing that we need to infuse a field with ultimate explanations doesn't negate the importance of proximate explanations. What you do is you need both levels of explanations to have a complete understanding of a phenomenon. So it's not an epistemological zero-sum game where by arguing for ultimate, proximate is losing. You need both. So let me give you a quick example. This is a great example to demonstrate the difference between these two. Pregnancy sickness is something that women experience around the world in a very predictable manner. If I were studying it from a proximate perspective, I might ask the question, how does the symptoms associated to pregnancy sickness change as a function of shifts in my hormone levels, a particular hormone? How does olfaction affect the likelihood of my having an attenuation or an increase of my pregnancy sickness? These are how, what questions. The ultimate explanation for pregnancy sickness would ask, why would it be the case that women would have evolved this particular physiological mechanism? Why, in the adaptive sense, in the evolutionary sense of the term? And the argument that some evolutionists, such as Poffe and Flaxman and Sherman, have proposed is that it's an adaptation to a particular environmental threat. Basically, what happens in pregnancy sickness is that it occurs at exactly the period that's known as organogenesis. This is where the embryo is forming its key organ, I mean, its main organs. This is the period where, if I now ingest certain pathogens, it becomes very, very dangerous for the development of these organs. One of the sources of pathogens that are one of the most common sources would be food pathogens, teratogens. And so pregnancy sickness is an evolved mechanism that tries to expel the possibility that I might have ingested teratogens. So you see again that it's not that one is better than the other. You need both explanations to have a complete understanding in this case of pregnancy sickness. Other important differences between evolutionary theory and other behavioral fields is this idea of how we view the mind. Does the mind consist of a bunch of domain general, general purpose computational systems, say classical conditioning, Pavlovian conditioning, or what evolutionary psychologists argue that no, we've developed domain specific computational systems that cater to very specific evolutionarily important problems. So that I would have evolved in the same way that my pancreas or my lungs or my kidneys have evolved to solve very specific adaptive functions, then the argument is that we've evolved distinct cognitive computational systems or mechanisms that are associated with things like mating, predator avoidance, forming friendships and coalitions, kin investments, how I navigate with my family. So each of these domain-specific contexts would have led to the evolution of clearly delineated and demarked domain-specific systems. So that's another key difference between evolutionary theory and other fields. And so this leads us, of course, to the idea that things such as learning, culture, and socialization, which is socialization is really broad shoulders, has very broad shoulders because we could associate any phenomenon to socialization. So why are men attracted to certain types of women? Well, it must be due to socialization. Why are women attracted to tall guys? It must be due to socialization, and so on and so forth. But of course, that explains nothing because it still begs the question, why is it that if it is socialization, that we are socialized to be of that particular penchant? And why is it seem that these socialization processes happen in universally consistent manners? So to say that something is due to learning or to culture literally explains almost nothing. And then, of course, a sequela of this is that the mind is not an empty slate, right? I'm not born with an empty mind with nothing in it that is subsequently filled by socialization. But of course, we come with certain biological penchants. Okay, so that gives you a very, very quick introduction to evolutionary theory. So as I mentioned, if you do a search of the literature in consumer behavior, if you look at textbooks of consumer behavior, actually in pretty much any field in the business sciences, if not in much of the social sciences, you'll find that people can develop very, very rich and very sophisticated disciplines that are otherwise completely void of anything dealing with biology. And if you look at the functional areas that are relevant to consumer scholars, many of the areas that are relevant to other psychologists and behavioral scientists, learning, motivation, perception, how do we form attitudes, how do we change attitudes, emotions, personality, decision making, these are all some of the classic functional areas that would be studied by consumer scholars. All of these are studied from a domain general and proximate level perspective, whereas, of course, as I mentioned, evolutionary psychologists would study it using a domain specific and ultimate level theorizing. Okay. So why the rejection? I'll probably spend a few minutes talking about this, again, to contextualize the debate, but one can spend hours talking about these types of issues. Some have spent years debating this issue. Why is there a rejection of biology and evolutionary theory? I'll I'll answer this question in the context specifically of consumer behavior, but many of these points apply to other social sciences. So in consumer behavior, most people typically are trained in one of a few distinct cognate disciplines. You could come from an anthropology background, a sociology background, or a psychology background. I'm talking here about behavioral, not the mathematical modeling, but say consumer behavior. So if I'm an anthropologist that's now studying consumer behavior, I'm likely to come from an emic perspective. What does that mean? Typically, you revel in highlighting cross-cultural differences. The Malaysians eat this type of food, but Ukrainians prefer this type of food, but the French like this type of advertising. And it's obviously quite facile to come up with a million cross-cultural differences. So an emic perspective says that every culture is different, every culture is unique, and so what we need to do as anthropologists is catalog these cross-cultural differences. Of course, that's quite antithetical to what most evolutionists would do, which is look for human universals, things that transcend culture, precisely because they are an inherent part of our biological heritage. Sociologists, of course, would, as I mentioned earlier, would argue for things like socialization. Why do men commit more crimes than women? Because they're socialized to be more criminal, which, of course, explains absolutely nothing. Sure, absolutely. Of course. The more you actually come to biological anthropology as opposed to cultural anthropology, the more you're likely to be sympathetic to human universals. Absolutely. As a matter of fact, there's an anthropologist who wrote a book called Human Universals. So it's not that every anthropologist doesn't believe in human universals, but most don't. But yes, you're right. So, if you come from a psychology background, then you're very much likely to either come from social psychology or from cognitive psychology, where you study the human mind as being an information processor, something that certainly people here in computer science might understand well. But again, it's coming from a domain general perspective. Now, this is slightly more problematic, and this is what others have called the anti-science movements, and you find people of this bent in consumer behavior. These would be guys, the postmodernists, there are no universal truths, the deconstructionists, there is no such thing as reality, language creates reality, academic feminists who will in large part argue that there are no sex differences. Any sex difference short of your genitalia is a social construction. And so, of course, these movements would be very unsympathetic to evolutionary theory. And so it creates, as you might imagine, quite a difficulty to try to infuse the field of consumer behavior with biological-based arguments when you have these types of gatekeepers at the door. So what are some of the standard misinformation regarding EP? And these, again, apply not just to consumer behavior. And incidentally, evolutionists have spent certainly the last 30 years addressing each of these points in incredibly convincing ways, yet these concerns seem to be immortal and to always exist, irrespective of how often you address them. So, of course, some argue, well, this is not serious science. It's post hoc explanations. Good science is when you do a 2x2 experiment. Anything short of that, where you don't have this kind of control, is not serious science, which, of course, then argues that paleontologists should not exist, astronomers should not exist, and a whole slew of natural scientists should not exist, if that's the benchmark of what good science is. Oh, evolutionary theory is just a bunch of cute, just-so stories, post hoc, unfalsifiable stories. So something like Darwinian theory that explains the evolution of every single biological organism on Earth is just a bunch of just-so storytelling. If you're an evolutionist, you must have some sinister political agenda. If you're an evolutionist, you must hate women. That's why you promulgate these sex differences. You must be a eugenicist, you must be a Nazi sympathizer, which in my case, it might be difficult to be a Nazi sympathizer since I'm Jewish, so I certainly can't be that. This is just vulgar biological determinism. Are you saying that everything is inscribed in our genes and we're just robots that are, executors of our genes? Of course it's not, because there's an interaction between our genes and the environment. And so no one is arguing that my genes make me do it and there's nothing that I could do about it. But this arises very often in my discussion with marketing colleagues, because they'll typically argue, if something is inscribed in my genes, how could marketers then have an influence in shaping consumer behavior? It's inscribed in the genes, you can't change it. That's completely erroneous. Then some are slightly more charitable. Yeah, okay, biology maybe matters, but is largely unimportant in understanding consumer behavior, which leads me to a quote that I absolutely love by J.B.S. Haldane, who is a famous evolutionist, who argued that epistemologically, all scientific theories go through four stages of acceptance. First, the gatekeepers will say, this is complete garbage. This is worthless nonsense. Then we move on to a slightly more charitable position. Yeah, this is interesting, but perverse point of view. And then we move to the next position. This is, yes, it's true, but quite unimportant. And then when the paradigmatic walls crumble, I always said it was that. I always agreed with you. And so unfortunately today, I'm still hovering in stages one, two, and three, depending on who I'm facing, at least not amongst my evolutionary colleagues, but certainly amongst my business school colleagues. And I'm hoping that one day, within my lifetime, we'll get to stage four. To give you, I don't have time to go through all this, but this is a table that I adapted from one of the chapters in my book, chapter two. I list to give you a sense of the breadth, the richness of fields that have adopted a Darwinian-based approach. So I won't go through all these. I mean, again, it would take a whole lecture, but you know, biopolitics, bioeconomics, there's a whole field in law that is dedicated to understanding law from an evolutionary and biological perspective. Evolutionary archaeology, architecture, Darwinian medicine, Darwinian psychiatry, neural Darwinism, this is something that some of you here would know, so evolutionary computation, Darwinian gastronomy, which I'll talk about in a second, and so on. Literary Darwinism is the idea that to study literature, there are certain recurring universal themes that you find in literature that are ultimately tied to our biological heritage, and so literary Darwinism. So you get a sense of the number of fields that have adopted Darwinian theory, which makes sense because we're talking about biological issues, or at least products that are derived from biological agents. So it's difficult to see how one can study any of these fields without ultimately recognizing that we're biological beings. So now I move next to showing you how we might create a more consilient consumer behavior discipline by showing you how we could map consumption acts onto one of four key Darwinian modules. Some of you might have heard of Maslow's hierarchy of needs. This is a very popular theory that is used by business school professors across different behavioral fields. Well, Maslow's hierarchy of needs is very nice, it's very intuitive, but actually empirically it's not founded on anything substantive. Rather, it was based on Maslow's humanistic. He was a humanist, and it was based on his humanistic view of how humans ought to be, whereby the highest level would be the level at which I self-actualize. But there's really no theoretical basis to the way that he constructed his hierarchy of needs. What I'm doing here instead is I am proposing that we could map these consumption acts onto four modules, not unlike how he tries to map them onto five levels. But these four modules are really evolutionary-based modules that actually are relevant in understanding the behavior not just of humans and not just of consumers, but of countless species. So I won't have time to go through all of these, but let me spend a bit of time going through some of them to give you a flavor. The four modules, by the way, just to kind of prepare you for what they are. First one is the reproductive module or the mating module. This is anything that relates to mating behavior. Then there is the survival module, anything that relates to, well, survival. Then the kin module or kin selection. Kin selection module stems from the idea that we extend our genes not only through direct reproductive fitness by my having children and hence propagating my genes, but I could also extend my genes by investing in those that are my kin, right? So I share a quarter of genes with my grandparents, on average half of the genes with my parents, I share some genes with my nephews, and so I could also be increasing my inclusive fitness by investing in my kin. And then I'll demonstrate how some consumption behaviors map onto this module. And then there's the reciprocity module, or the reciprocal altruism module. This is stuff that relates to group formation, alliances, friendships. So the I scratch your back, you scratch mine. And that is very much rooted in an evolutionary mechanism, which I'll talk about in a second. So let's talk very briefly about the reproductive module. So if you look at gift giving as a courtship ritual, so for example, De Beers, the diamond companies around the world advertises its diamond rings, and it advertises them in a very specific, I mean, sex-specific manner. It is expected that in this case, men are the ones who are going to engage in this courtship signal or courtship ritual. Very much like in most species, sexually reproducing species, you might have nuptial gifts or courtship ritual gifts that are sex-specific in their instantiation. Here's another very good example of something that could not have been studied unless you're coming from a biological basis. So which preferences I prefer for perfume is not so much based on advertising or brand loyalty or all of the things that you might hear in a consumer behavior class, but it turns out, I mean, those are important factors, but it turns out that a very good predictor of my self-preference, the preference that I prefer for a particular perfume, is related to MHC. What's MHC? This is really each of our unique immunogenetic profiles. MHC stands for major histocompatibility complex. So we each have a unique immunogenetic profile. Actually, we tend to marry or mate with people that are maximally distinct on MHC because we want to have a heterogeneous profile for our offspring. And so it turns out that what predicts each of our preferences for perfume is linked to our own, if you'd like, chemical signature. And so it's very difficult to argue that this particular consumer choice is based on anything other than a biological, you know, basis. Toy preferences, I put this example up because some social theorists argue that what makes us male or female is the fact that we are socialized with toys from a very young age. So given that little John receives the blue truck and plays stuff with G.I. Joe, and little Linda plays with the pink doll, that's then what sets up the whole cascade of sex differences. And frankly, that's quite silly. Rather, if you even look at, never mind universal patterns of toy preferences, but if you look at across species, you do the same study with vervet monkeys, you'll find that the vervet monkeys' preferences, whether they be male or female, is based on exactly the same preferences that you find in the human context. And of course, I would think that it would be difficult to argue that toy preferences in vervet monkeys were based on socialization or watching cartoons. Cosmetic and plastic surgeries, this is a beautification process. So it's not surprising that to the extent that beauty is a premium that is very sex specific in terms of universal mating preferences, then that you would find that this particular consumption act is overwhelmingly dominated by women. And it's not dominated by women only in the US or only in Peru. You give me the data from a country, from any country that you want, and I will guarantee you that it will be roughly that. High heels, it turns out that high heels are intoxicating to men, and hence women wear them for a very specific biological reason, because it actually tickles a visual preference that men hold. High heels actually create something called lordosis. Lordosis is the sexually receptive position that females take when they're about to mate. It actually raises the buttocks by roughly 30 degree angle. So this is why you see pornographic actors wearing high heels, I mean female pornographic actors, or you see if you go to a strip bar, they're dancing all of these intricate dances that are very dangerous, that would otherwise make a lot more sense for them to be wearing soft shoes, yet they're wearing them with high heels precisely because it is appealing to my evolved visual preferences. Provocative attire, this is an amazing finding. We're actually doing some research on the links between menstrual cycle and consumption. How women dress is highly correlated with where they are in their menstrual cycle. If you ask women, they will certainly tell you, I feel sexy, I feel unattractive, I feel bloated, I feel receptive to sex or not, I eat differently depending on where I am in my menstrual cycle. And it turns out that I actually dress differently depending on where I am in my menstrual cycle. The closer I am to my maximally fertile stage of my ovulatory cycle, this is when I am most scantily clad. The evolutionary reason or the biological reason is very simple. When I am maximally fertile, this is when I want to be advertising to prospective suitors. I may not engage in mating, but I certainly want to be advertising, hey suitors, look at me. Classic consumption, but in the context of the mating arena. I won't go through all these, but you get the general idea. Let me just mention one very quick one. I spent quite a bit of time in yesterday's talk on this. With one of my graduate students, we recently conducted a study where we looked at testosterone and conspicuous consumption. We actually had men come into the lab, and they either drove a Porsche, which we actually rented a Porsche as part of the research design, or an old beaten-up sedan from 1989, and we actually tracked their T levels, their testosterone levels, across both what are called leks. Leks are, a lek in zoology is a physical space where typically males go to engage in sexual signaling while the females sit around at the periphery, at the outskirts of the lek, looking at the different males, and then they pick the optimal male, whatever the optimality criteria might be in that species. And so here we ran this study both in leks, downtown Montreal, where everybody is congregating, everybody is showing off, and on a somewhat deserted highway. And then we found, not surprisingly, that young males, when you put them in a Porsche, their T levels shoot up. So you are literally engaging in a sexual signal, very much like other males would do in countless other species. So we're not different from other animals, we're just a different type of animal. Let me mention a few others quickly. So now we move on to the survival module. So gustatory preferences, so my taste buds, are really an evolutionary solution to something that we all face or our ancestors faced, which most animals face every day. Most animals spend most of their day either avoiding predators, either trying to find dinner or trying to, or avoiding to, of becoming dinner. That's what most of us, even most humans in our evolutionary context, would have spent most of their time doing nothing but that. So we face an environment of caloric scarcity and caloric uncertainty. Therefore, each of us in this room has taste buds of ancestors that like to eat bison more than they did raw broccoli. This is why the top 20 restaurants in the world have one thing in common. It's not whether they all advertise in a particular way or whether they have sexy celebrity endorsers. They all do one thing in exactly the same way, is that they deliver fat to you in a way that appeals to your gustatory preferences. I would challenge anybody in this room to maybe start a chain of restaurants of raw broccoli, and I could maybe give you $10 million for an advertising campaign, and then I'd love to follow how your sales go. Or I could predict to you right now what the sales will be. Zero. Darwinian gastronomy is a slightly different twist on the idea. While gustatory preferences says that our taste buds are an evolutionary solution to an adaptive problem, and hence it's a human universal, Darwinian gastronomy says, but obviously there are culinary tradition differences. The foods that constitutes Indian culinary tradition is different from Lebanese culinary tradition. So what evolutionists have done is they've tried to look at what shapes these culinary differences. And here we borrow something from behavioral ecology. Behavioral ecologists, who are evolutionists, usually study differences as adaptations to local environments. So here in this case, you could study things like how much salt is consumed within a culture, how much spices are consumed, is it more vegetable-based or meat-based? And it turns out that you could very easily predict these differences as a function of the ambient temperature of that particular culture, the ambient temperature of the environment, which is, of course, correlated to latitude. And so again, culinary traditions don't evolve as just a mysterious, oh, it's due to culture, which again doesn't explain a single thing. I could replace the word culture by X and it would explain as much. But rather, it evolves because it is an adaptation to a local environment. Let me just mention one or two others here. So situational hunger and food shopping. Many years ago, Richard Nisbet, a very famous psychologist, demonstrated that if you look at grocery shopping, people's list, how much they actually buy, is very well predicted by how situationally hungry they were when they purchased. And so this is a proxy mechanism that's linked to caloric hoarding. When I'm hungry, I gorge. The M&M study, I can't go through all of these, but I picked the ones that, you know, I think you might resonate nicely with you guys. M&M study, you bring in two containers of M&Ms. One is unicolored, the other one is multicolored. There's absolutely no taste difference because it's a colorless, tasteless food colorant, and yet people end up consuming a lot more of the multicolored one. Why? Well, one argument might be that it's because it is tickling, if you'd like, my visual system for preference for variety seeking. Very much like how I might sample a variety of foods. In this case, I'm seeing different colors, and so it's usurping my visual system to eat more. Moving on to the kin selection module, this is the one that regulates, as I mentioned, relationships within families. So we did a study a few years ago on gift giving to kin, and it turns out, not surprisingly, that how much money I spend to various kin members is very highly correlated to the genetic relatedness of those kin. So genetic relatedness is a measure of how much genes I share on average. So as I said, if I had an identical twin, the score would be 1. I share all my genes with my identical twin. With my brother, it's 0.5. With my grandparents, it's 0.25. And it turns out that that measure of genetic relatedness really predicts the gift-giving behavior. Here's a great one. Again, I can't go through all these. I wish I had more time. This is a fantastic one. It's a very fancy term. Differential grandparental solicitude. We all arise from 4 grandparents. If it were simply due to genetic relatedness, then all of our 4 grandparents, you would think it's the genetic relatedness coefficient is 0.25. But if you now introduce one other variable into the mix, something called, which is very relevant in evolutionary theory, certainly in mating behavior, something called paternity uncertainty, right? We always know who the mother is. We never know who the father is. Of course, today we have DNA paternity testing, but we didn't in our evolutionary past. Well, then we would expect that the maternal grandmother, and the maternal grandmother is absolutely no uncertainty, versus the paternal grandfather, where there are 2 layers, 2 levels of paternity uncertainty, we would expect them to invest the most and the least in their grandchildren. And this is exactly what is found. It's very, very difficult to argue for this finding, or to even think of studying this finding, if you weren't coming from an evolutionary perspective. And then finally, the reciprocity module. So this is, as I mentioned, what guides our behaviors in terms of forming friendships, group alliances, group formation. So if you look at things like in sports, basking in reflected glory, Bob Cialdini, a very famous social psychologist, many years ago, he demonstrated that if you look at after a football team, a university football team has either won or lost on Sunday, and then you simply count the number of people, number of students that the next day wear the memorabilia, the insignia of the university, well then, depending on whether we won on Sunday, a lot of us wear it, and if we lost, few of us wear it. And what is the evolutionary explanation? He didn't provide an evolutionary explanation, but my post hoc evolutionary explanation would be that if you look across species, social species, we tend to want to affiliate with winners, we tend to want to disassociate from losers. And so in this case, we are making a real consumption choice. What am I going to wear tomorrow as a function of this idea of assorting with winners or disassociating from losers? This has been pushed to a much more granular level. Bernhard and his friends looked at the World Cup in 1998 and looked at the testosterone level of spectators. We know for a fact that if you look at the actual participants in a sports contest, depending on whether I'm losing or winning, my T levels go up or down. But the spectators, this is vicarious physiological measure. So if I love the French national team and my team is now losing, my T levels go down. If now they score and they're now winning, my T level goes up. Again, this physiological mechanism is rooted in a clear biological system. So this gives you a sense of how we might use evolutionary theory to organize, to create a consilient taxonomy of the field of consumer behavior. Let's move on quickly to other areas. So next I'll move very, very quickly. So advertising, again, if you're a social constructivist, you'll say what makes most men attracted to young women is because they learn it by looking at Cosmopolitan or because they watch the Oprah show. But had we not had the good fortune of watching Cosmopolitan, or we might have been attracted to basketballs or maybe giraffes or maybe posts. As a matter of fact, there is a field of study that argues that even heterosexuality is nothing but a learned, socialized response. Of course, I argue something very different. I argue that advertisers, while they may not know the Darwinian reasons behind what they do, they do recognize that we are biological beings, and they do provide us with images that are congruent with our evolved human nature. So if you look at the use of physically attractive people, physically attractive people are used to sell all kinds of things precisely because there's a very clear reason why we're attracted to physically attractive people. It's because they're literally sending a signal, I am genetically fit. Attractive people, typically by attractive, it's synonymous to saying I am facially symmetric. Facial symmetry is a strong marker of good phenotypic quality. And this is why an advertiser that's selling anything puts a beautiful person next to the product. You have an affect transfer in a very predictable way. Another practical way that evolutionary theory can help advertising practitioners is in this old idea of global versus local advertising. Some of you have taken an advertising course would have certainly touched upon this. So global advertising strategy would be, I am Coca-Cola, I'm headquartered in Atlanta. Should I develop one advertising message that I then export everywhere around the world? That's global. Or should it be a local advertising strategy? I tweak it to each local environment. And after 80 years of debate, people are not any closer to resolving the debate whether global or local is better. And I argue that the reason why they haven't been able to solve this debate is because they haven't had the correct framework to be able to answer the question. And perhaps not surprisingly, given the topic that I'm discussing today, I argue that evolutionary psychology, or evolutionary theory more generally, allows you to answer that question. There are certain things that are human universals, and I know that they're human universals, therefore those can easily fit within the global context. So the fact that men will react in very predictable manners to scantily clad women is something that I can assure you will occur in very predictable ways around the world. On the other hand, the color green does not have an evolutionary basis. In other words, there's no reason why every single person around the world should understand the color green to be one thing. Some cultures view green as a sign of fertility or a proxy for fertility. Others view green as a proxy of disease. And so in this case, a local advertising strategy. I better understand that green means one thing in one culture and it means something else in another. So evolutionary theory allows me to understand these types of issues such as global and local advertising. Very, very quickly, to link back to the earlier thing, I was talking about the four modules, here are examples of slogans, and there's literally millions of these that I could give you, that cater to one of the slogans. So when monogamy becomes monotony, this is an actual slogan by an online dating service that specializes in connecting people that are married and that are looking for extra pair copulations. This is the very cold zoological, biological term, or the less zoological term, cheating with another partner. So when monogamy becomes monotony is, of course, mapped onto into the mating module. There are a million and one excuses for not wearing a safety belt. Some are real killers. This is catering to the survival module, of course, safety. Genes are for passing on to your children, not to the IRS. This is catering to the kin selection module. And then give me Frito corn chips and I'll be your friend. You give me one thing, I'll give you something else. This is the reciprocity arrangement. Moving on. So I talked very briefly about one form of cultural product, advertising, but we could expand the story to a wide range of other cultural products. And I'll talk about some of these. I won't have, unfortunately, time to talk about all of them. Television themes, soap operas, talk shows, movies, songs, music videos, self-help books, literary narratives, religious narratives, art, all of these, you could imagine them, they're really fossils of the human mind, right? The paleontologists can go and actually unearth bones to try to understand the species. In a sense, these cultural products constitute part of our fossilized human nature. So by studying these cultural products, I can hopefully make a statement about things that are universal, that are true of all people. So let me give you a few examples. I hope some of these are exciting because everybody loves, for example, Seinfeld. So let's take television themes. Does anybody know what the Master of My Domain show was about? It's okay, we're being filmed, but you could say the word. What is it? It was about what?
Masturbation.
Exactly. So this was the episode where the four main characters, the three males and the one female character, engage in a contest to see, so the euphemism, Master of My Domain, is can I resist my masturbatory urges? And the one who resists them the longest is the one who wins. How is this related to evolutionary theory? Well, let's break down some of the actual storyline. Well, first, we know that Elaine, who's the only female character out of the four, has to put in a lot more money into the pot to participate in the bet. That's inherent recognition that this particular task is easier for one sex than it is for the other. And actually, there's very interesting literature that has looked at the evolutionary reasons as to why masturbation exists. And they're somewhat different for men and women. So already the screenwriters, while they might have not known all of the evolutionary reasons behind what makes the storyline sellable, they certainly know that there exist biological differences between the sexes. And then the next point I'm going to talk about is what led to each of the different actors, in this case characters, succumbing to their masturbatory urges is very indicative of human mate preferences, universal mate preferences. So if you look at Kramer, the sort of eclectic neighbor, what pushes him over the edge is that there's a woman across the street, a young, beautiful, attractive woman that's scantily clad, that is doing her exercise day in and day out, and he has to face this visual stimulus, and he could no longer take it, and he loses his part in the bet. So here we recognize that the trigger in men is often going to be a visual-based stimulus. On the other hand, when it comes to Elaine, what pushes her over the edge, does anybody remember what it is?
John Kennedy.
That's right. It's the fantasy of becoming his wife, Mrs. John F. Kennedy Jr., is the idea that I could now be involved in a long-term mating situation with a very high-status male that actually tickles my fancy. So the screenwriters were clearly aware, without necessarily knowing what the evolutionary reasons are, that there are things that are different between the two sexes. So good storylines, whether they be in the movies or on television shows, are going to be storylines that are consistent with our evolved human nature, rather than we're empty minds and it's the movies that teaches us how to act. Soap operas, if you look at telenovelas in Latin America, or you look at Hindi soap operas, or if you look at General Hospital, or if you look at Arabic soap operas, they're literally identical, with only some of the acting either being slightly more over the top or slightly less, and the language being different. But the storylines is basically one of four or five variations. He thinks it's John's kid, but it's really Bob's. Sibling rivalry, ascending the social hierarchy, and so on and so forth. So there's a set of clear Darwinian pursuits that come up in every soap opera that you can imagine. Talk shows, actually this happened today. I even watched a commercial for an upcoming Maury Povich episode, and it was about paternity testing. It seems as though every single show of Maury Povich now is nothing but DNA paternity testing. Well, why is that something that would have ratings? Well, because it's a very dramatic context. It's something that is actually quite dramatic in our evolutionary history to face this idea of paternity uncertainty. And now we could actually find out right away whether I've been cuckolded or not, whether my woman has been with another man or not. Movies, very, very quickly, I only have about 10 minutes left, 10. So movies, I won't go through all these, but look at Indecent Proposal, very famous movie about 15 years ago. Robert Redford is a rich industrialist. He meets a young couple, Demi Moore and Woody Harrelson, and he engages in a conversation with them where they're convinced that it's not true that every single person could be bought for a price, And so he poses the following question, which leads to a very dramatic dilemma, and that is, well, how about if I give you $1 million so I could spend one night with your wife? And spending one night with your wife, he literally means that he could have sex with her. And then, of course, there is a very serious dramatic tension. There's a real dilemma here. Is am I willing to allow sexual access to my wife from another man? If the storyline had been reversed, there wouldn't have been much of an emotional dilemma. If it would have been a rich woman industrialist approaching a couple, I'd be willing to bet that as she is proposing the thing, before she finishes proposing it, the wife would have said, don't let the door hit your behind on the way out. Deposit the $1 million in account 107 at the Swiss Zurich Bank. And that is the case, not because, again, we were socialized. It's because granting sexual access of our partner, if we're men or women, doesn't carry the same cost. And people who write screens are aware of that. And that's why they write those screens. Songs, we're doing right now a content analysis of some songs. We're specifically looking at hip-hop songs. And if you look at but they may not be hip-hop songs. It could be any kind of music that you want. The language might be slightly different. But the things that people sing about is almost universally the same. Roughly 95, I can't remember the exact number, 95 or 97% of songs around the world deal with one issue, mating. So you don't have to be a particularly sophisticated evolutionist to recognize why it is that troubadours in the 12th century and poets in the 4th century BC and hip-hop artists today are singing of the same exact issues. Males sing about, I am rich, I'm powerful, look at my Aston Martin, and look at the beautiful girl, and then women sing about similar things that are relevant to their mating domains. So I won't go through all of these, but you get the general idea. We could study each of these as though we are anthropologists going through these fossils of popular culture to understand the evolution of the human mind. I'm almost going to wrap up soon. This is a good one. To give you a bit of a sense, and here I've got music lyrics for all tastes. I've got ragamuffin Jamaican music. I've got, what have I got? I've got hip hop, I've got soul, I've got some country music. We're in the Midwest, maybe some folks like country music. So let me give you some examples. This is a ragamuffin Jamaican singer, Lord Shorty. Thou shall have no other man but me. If thou see me with the next girl talking, try and understand, pass me straight like you ain't know me, let me have my woman. He's basically saying, I'm allowed to have other women, but you can't. And if any of you know anything about universal human mating practices, roughly 85% of societies are polygynous, meaning one man, multiple women. Very few are monogamous, and less than 1%, actually much less than 1%, are polyandrous, one woman, multiple men. And so the songs typically reflect that reality. Sister Sledge, a soul group from the 70s, they're talking about this beautiful man that they're seeing at a discotheque. He wears the finest clothes, the best designers heaven knows, ooh, from his head down to his toes, Halston, Gucci, Fiorucci, he looks like a steal, that man is just to kill. What makes him attractive is that he is sending all kinds of cues of his social status. They're not talking about his thundering muscular soccer legs, they're talking about signs that are particularly appealing to women in the mating arena. Gwen Guthrie, she was a dance music singer. Her song became so popular that this one particular line has made it now into the popular culture vernacular. So if you ain't got a job, because ain't nothing going on but the rent, you've got to have a job if you want to be with me. Ain't nothing going on but the rent. No romance without finance. Okay. Destiny's Child, a contemporary group, Beyoncé Knowles and her friends. I won't go through the whole thing, but basically they're saying, you either start giving me some resources, you better start showing me that you're a serious guy, or else I kick you to the curb. TLC's No Scrubs. Here, scrubs doesn't mean the medical scrubs, which is a high status symbol. Scrubs in this particular vernacular refers to a loser guy. So you have a shorty, a girlfriend, but you don't show no love. Oh, yes, and I'm talking to you. Want to get with me with no money? Oh, no, I don't think so. Okay. Missy Elliott, a contemporary hip-hop singer. She's talking about what constitutes hot guys, attractive guys. maybe you got what I want, see, because you all be driving Jaguars and the Bentleys and the Rolls Royce, playing hardball with them platinum visas. And then, as I promised, those of you that like country music, actually this song led to an actual social psychology experiment that was very famous in 1979. The title of the song is "Don't the Girls All Get Prettier at Closing Time?" Ain't it funny, ain't it strange, the way a man's opinion change when he starts to face that lonely night, right? So the idea that I relax my threshold of acceptance as I'm getting closer to ending up alone that night is something that is much more common for men to do than it would be for women, precisely because the costs and benefits of mating are not the same for the sexes. So all of these songs and 13 billion other songs are reflective of our evolved human mating preferences. Very, very quickly, I'll only have a chance to sort of tickle your curiosity. Then in one of the chapters of my book, I talk about dark side consumption, as I mentioned earlier. So these are consumption acts that lead to deleterious consequences. So pornography, pathological gambling, compulsive buying, eating disorders, excessive sun tanning. This is a paper that I recently published with a dermatologist. Each of these have one thing in common. Can anybody guess what that might be?
Addiction?
I mean, in that general sense, yes, but...
Dopamine systems involved.
Sure. Yes, okay. How can I... Well, maybe I shouldn't... I'm thinking here I'm eliciting participation grades. You all get 10% participation. So maybe I got to get out of that mode. What they all share in common is that they tend to be extremely sex-specific in their morbidity rates, in their epidemiology. So, for example, when it comes to sun tanning, despite the fact that women are much more knowledgeable about the consequences of sun tanning, they tend to sun tan much more, which, by the way, attacks a central tenet in social marketing, which basically says that the reason why we do these bad behaviors is because we didn't know any better. But if only the government or some other source could teach us how to behave, gee, the behavior would no longer exist. And that exactly proves that that's not the case. Well, sun tanning, much more female-based. Pornography is completely male-based. Pathological gambling, it's almost exclusively, not 100%, but much more dominated by males. Compulsive buying is 90% females, irrespective. It's been studied in many, many widely different cultures. It's women that succumb to compulsive buying, eating disorders. As a matter of fact, not only it's only women that, or largely women that succumb to it universally, but actually Hippocrates, right? The founder of medicine, right? Physicians take the Hippocratic Oath when they graduate. Well, Hippocrates had already documented cases of eating disorders several thousand years ago, before there was Cosmopolitan, before there was the Oprah show, before we had pretty women in the catwalks of New York. And lo and behold, it was still women that were overwhelmingly the ones who succumbed to eating disorders. So to argue that it's the media that made me this way, literally, is perfectly false. So, and I won't get into any more what is the Darwinian root of some of these, but if you're interested, I can certainly discuss it privately with you after. So to conclude, what are some of the benefits that might be reaped in Darwinizing consumer behavior? I'll begin, actually I had several quotes, but I probably won't have time to go through all of them, so let me maybe put this one up. So this is a quote that Kenrick and Simpson, these are two evolutionary psychologists, and this is a quote that relates to psychology and social psychology specifically. So here's what they ask. Why are the many theories in one chapter of a social psychology text often discontinuous with many theories presented in other chapters? Why does such an important field in the social and behavioral sciences, one that studies so many significant topics that are vital to understanding human behavior, not have a meta theory, one capable of tying different research areas and disparate findings together? Well, this is exactly what I argue for consumer behavior. If you study consumer behavior, you see just a hodgepodge of completely disconnected, disjointed theories. And that can't be good if we want to call ourselves a mature science. Physics, chemistry, biology are certainly more influential sciences, not necessarily because they have smarter people. It's because they've developed fields that are very consilient, that are guided by meta theories that everybody could agree on. So what is bottom line? Last slide. I don't have time to go over some of the empirical research. So what are the benefits of Darwinizing consumer research? As I just mentioned a few seconds ago, it allows us to achieve greater consilience. It allows us to organize the field. Evolutionary psychology can be used as an epistemological heuristic. What does that mean? Well, take, for example, something called the selectivity hypothesis. This is something that is common in consumer behavior, which basically says that irrespective of the domain, when it comes to information search, women search for more information and men search for less information, irrespective of whether they're choosing mates or toothpaste or cars or investment funds. Well, an evolutionist would argue that that simply can't be the case. It makes no sense to argue that irrespective of the domain, women are more comprehensive processors. There are some domains where men are much more likely to be the comprehensive processors, and others where it's likely to be much more so the women. Another benefit of evolutionary theory is it allows us to augment our explanatory power by recognizing, as I've been saying throughout the talk, the importance of ultimate explanations and domain-specific theorizing. And it allows us to posit new hypotheses and uncover new phenomena that would have been otherwise invisible to us. There's no way that you could have studied the relationship between menstrual cycle and how I dress if you weren't coming from an evolutionary bent. So the bottom line for evolutionary behavioral sciences, but certainly behavioral sciences in general, is that consumer behavior is truly one of the richest arenas to study evolutionary principles. I'm done. Thank you very much.